As the global leader in choline, Balchem has spent more than 50 years perfecting the art and science of choline chloride production. The new Puricol line delivers the highest standards of quality, produced in state-of-the-art manufacturing facilities, and backed by the strictest process controls, for a level of purity, safety, and consistency you can't find anywhere else. Turn to Puricol choline chloride from Balchem for an unmatched level of quality you can trust. Visit BalchemANH.com to learn more. Good morning, everyone, or afternoon for our friends outside of the U.S. My name is Kim Jones, marketing representative for Balchem, and welcome to the Real Science Lecture Series. Many of the talks we've been doing for the last 15 months have focused on the result of research studies. Today, we'll be taking a little different approach and focusing on study design and how to optimize understanding of antibiotic-free protocols. Dr. Matthew Jones from the Southern Poultry Research Group takes us through some of the newest techniques and equipment available to maximize our understanding. Dr. Jones is a poultry scientist based in Athens, Georgia, with a combined background in veterinary medicine and nutrition. He is able to facilitate tailored and applied poultry experiments. Originally from the City of Roses, Thomasville, Georgia, Matthew traveled to the University of Georgia in Athens for undergraduate studies in 2008. After studying avian biology and biological science, he completed a doctorate in veterinary medicine from UGA, as well as a PhD in poultry science. During his graduate studies, Matthew's area of focus was the influence of various feed additives on digestibility and enteric health under Dr. Adam Davis. Matthew worked as Director of Research and Technical Services for Ezomite Mineral Products, where he gained additional experience in applied research and feed manufacturing. His current role at the Southern Poultry Research Group requires involvement in many aspects of applied poultry research, with an emphasis on challenge models, allowing him to merge and further his understanding of both veterinary medicine and nutritional health. Matthew, you should now have control of the screen.
Thank you. Thank you, Kim, for the introduction. I'm really excited to be here and to be a part of this series, as well as introducing this topic, because research design is really important, and I feel like it really drives the industry. Something that Kim said was introducing new techniques, and I will mention some specifics later on in the discussion. But a lot of what I'm going to present today are fundamentals, because it's easy to get distracted trying to answer a lot of questions at one time. And so focusing on the fundamentals really helps guide the research. And also, I feel like focusing on the fundamentals will help reach a broader audience that I know has joined us today. So with that, I'm going to introduce myself a little bit more. Like she said, I did grow up in Thomasville, Georgia, South Georgia, and came up to Athens for all of my schooling. So I was in Athens for about a decade in my various disciplines. After graduate school, I went to Ezomite Mineral Products, and the focus there was more on feed manufacturing than the previous disciplines of veterinary medicine and nutrition. So I was able to kind of diversify my understanding even more so. From Ezomite, I came to Southern Poultry Research Group, where we do applied health-based poultry research. And it's a very unique situation because I'm able to be a nutritionist and a veterinarian on most days. So in the morning, I might come in and score some lesions. This would be cocci lesions. I don't know if y'all can see my cursor. I'm gonna try to bring it in. And this would be more of a normal cica here at the bottom. Tenella is typically the imeria we look for in the cica. And you can see the cica at the top appears a little bit more thickened, and you can see a little bit of hemorrhaging here on the outside. So when you cut it, you can score the extent of the lesion. The reason that I took this picture I was working with Dr. Mathis on a Coxie discussion and realized that all of my pictures were more severe lesions, and so this would be a more mild tenella lesion. And after a morning of scoring, I might be able to sit down and formulate some diets in an upcoming nutrition study or veterinary study for that matter. And so it's a really unique situation where I get to kind of blend both of those worlds to some extent. And the third category that I guess I fall in is new father. This is my son. I'm a very proud father of a 1-year-old now. Like I said, the worlds tend to bleed over. So I sent this picture to a good friend who's a swine nutritionist, and the typical dad text, right? I said, "Hey, how are you doing? You know, Leland's growing fast, right?" So I sent that off, and his prompt response was, "What was his average daily gain?" And so I nerdily enough calculated that back, because you have a pretty good starting weight and time. So the worlds tend to bleed over into one another, but that's not necessarily a bad thing. So going back to the topic that y'all all came to listen in on is research. So at Southern Poultry Research Group, we perform mostly applied poultry experiments. You can see the picture there. These three houses that I'm trying to circle with my cursor are the houses where we perform most of our research. And so we do primarily broiler studies, but we also do layer studies and turkey studies, as well as broiler breeder studies from time to time. Most of our research kind of falls into two categories, enteric health and food safety. Enteric health studies might be coccidiosis or necrotic enteritis experiments, whereas food safety would be mostly salmonella and campylobacter studies. We do applied poultry performance and some of those others listed below, just not as frequently as the two main buckets. For the purposes of this discussion, I'm going to focus more on enteric health and considerations when doing those types of studies. So this is more to remind me to have a disclaimer early on. So according to the book, Acervulina, which is a coccidiosis in chickens, usually affects the proximal intestine here in the duodenum. And usually Maxima infects this middle portion of the intestine in the jejunum. But there are times, like that picture over there on the right, where Maxima ends up in the duodenum and you just adapt to those situations. So similarly, I'm going to present a set of guidelines and kind of steps. And there are gonna be exceptions to every rule that I lay out. It's just more of a fundamental guideline for those of you that have joined us today. So my discussion can be broken into two major topics. First, I'm going to talk about where we start when we are designing research trials and two really important questions to answer early on in the process. And then the second half of the discussion will be on how to optimize design in challenge scenarios. So the first question that really is probably you want to ask yourself when you're thinking about design is what are we going to do with this data? So start with the end in mind. And by starting with the end in mind, I'm talking about the major buckets that you're gonna do at the end when you have the data. And those, as I see it, are broadly internal use, marketing, and publishing. And the reason you want to start with that in mind is picking which of these buckets you're gonna focus on is gonna guide your experimental design really early in the process. And here, this is not an exhaustive list. These are just some examples of why you might want to know early on. So if you are focusing on internal use, you don't need necessarily to make sure the study is gonna be as applied as possible. You're gonna want to make sure it's as controlled as possible, and then you're going to use that to move into a more applied study. Also, on the internal use side, you might not need a negative control depending on what you're looking at. So if you're looking at maybe multiple products, you might want to know how they do in relation to one another and in relation to a challenge control. And that negative control is taking up space that you could have more replicates for the other treatments. So just a consideration to keep in mind. On the marketing side of things, you're going to want to make sure you have applied data, and you're going to want to make sure you answer specific questions to the audience that you're targeting. On the other hand, publishing, you're going to want to make sure you have those negative controls so that you can benchmark the samples that you collect in relation to a non-challenge group. The second question that you're going to want to ask yourself is, if we can answer or learn only one thing in this study, what would it be? And that is a really tough thing to do, but focusing on that one thing, even if other you learn other things in the process, will help help the outcome of the study. So under one condition is best, because as you add layers to the product, to the experimental design, you're going to increase your variability, and it's going to be more difficult to interpret. So looking here, right, so you might want to know how a product does under specific dietary stress, or under maybe an environmental stress, or a pathogen stress like the Amaria challenge there. You're going to want to pick one of those challenges at a time, rather than immersing the birds in all of those combined, because it's going to increase your variation, and it's going to take replicates away because you're going to have to control for each of those. So a lot of times what ends up happening is you really want to put everything, you know, in general, and I do the same thing. I want to learn everything in one study, but what that does is it loses focus, and you tend to lose replicates. And so it makes the outcome more difficult to interpret. And not only does it make the outcome more difficult to interpret, but the risk is you don't answer the one thing that's most important, that one thing that's going to move you on to the next step in the research process. So focus is really important, and I will highlight that as we continue to move forward. This is the general process that I see as it fits into those end goals, as well as focusing on one question at a time. So the first question you're going to ask yourself is, do we have a product, or what blends of products do we have? And the starting point typically is in vitro. So screening products in a tube so that we know kind of a handful of products that we want to evaluate in vivo. And we're going to take those products into a battery cage study like the one here below. And you might ask, why are we going to use battery cages? We're going to want to use battery cages early on in the process because we can typically get more replication and into a tighter space. And so that'll help on the economical side, as well as improving the number of replicates. And we're going to want to use batteries because we're going to gain some control. You can see in that picture below that those birds are on wire floor. And so there's some separation between their feces and them. So that'll take the pathogen recycling out of the equation and add a level of control to the study. And the other reason we're going to want to use battery cages is we can have a quicker turnaround. So typically battery cages go to 21 or 28 days, and you can have a battery cage done and the next maybe experiment placed in the same amount of time that it would take for a similar floor pin trial. The downside to using battery cages is it's not as an applied model. So the people that are being presented to aren't going to be able to relate to birds reared under these conditions. So this is just to move you towards that step in the process. So once you have a product, the next step in the process is a dose titration. So trying to find the optimal dose for your product, and then you're going to keep that in a battery cage as well. if you don't already have a route of administration, a battery cage is a good step to do that study in, just to determine whether you want to keep it in the feed or the water or apply it in some other way. So once we have a product, a dose, and a route of administration, we're ready to move on into the next step, out of kind of the internal use category into more of a marketing type study. And that would be a floor pin model. So we're going to rear the birds under more similar conditions to what they might see on the integrator side. A couple considerations you're going to want to take, and we'll talk more about this in the latter half of the presentation, but you're going to want to know what is the primary metric that we're going to focus on. And you're going to want to consider the target audience and the challenges they face when you're considering that metric. And that will kind of flow into the challenge design as well as the replication. And we'll talk, like I said, more about that in just a minute. So if we have all of this data, we've answered yes up until this point. We have a product, a dose, a route of administration, and successful recent applied floor pin model. We can kind of branch off into a couple different directions. The first would be a mechanism of action. So how does this product work? And a lot of times you might want to go back to a tightly controlled battery study, just because you can get a little bit more control and test a specific hypothesis. The other way you can go from that point is continued understanding. So kind of under specific conditions, how is my product going to respond? So let's say it's a product with some efficacy against coccidiosis. You might want to find out early on how it's going to influence coccidiosis vaccine cycling. Similarly, if the product is bactericidal or thought to be bactericidal, you might want to run a study with probiotics to make sure there's no influence there. And so these are kind of specific questions that you might want to answer and that you will probably be asked as you move forward. So both of these buckets kind of answer questions that are coming from the industry. So they're both marketing as well as publishing, potentially academic type research. So this is just a breakdown of maybe a different depiction of how that flow goes. So you identify the product and then the dose and route in battery cages for internal use mostly. And then you're going to do some applied floor pin trials before you go into more specific circumstances and mechanism of action. And I simplified it maybe a little bit too much. Something that you're going to want to make sure you do is when you're testing products is to have multiple institutions come to the same conclusion about the product. If we did a study here, you'd want studies elsewhere under similar conditions that turned out similarly as far as on the marketing side. This is just a general overview. All right. So, like I mentioned, the second half of the discussion is going to be more geared towards design. And there's three major things that help distinguish differences in experimental design, and that would be standardization, statistical design, and in our case, challenge design. I'm going to try to hit on some fundamentals that would be broadly applicable to research, but there are some specific circumstances that are going to be geared more towards the types of research that we do here. So the first thing you're going to want to make sure you standardize is the environment. So you want all of the birds to have exactly the same environmental conditions. Standardization in general, and this is going to apply to some of the subsequent slides, you're trying to limit the variation as much as possible. And as you limit variation, that's going to increase your likelihood to declare those differences. So from an environmental perspective, you're going to want those birds to have exactly the same bedding. So whether that's fresh litter or fresh shaving, or a reuse litter, you're going to want to have them all distributed the same. So if they do have reuse litter here, what we often do is we'll put all of the litter in the middle of the house and blend it all together before we distribute it back into the pens. You're going to want to make sure you have the same number of birds per square feet, and that'll kind of flow into the next slide. And you're going to want to make sure the environment is as uniform as possible. And so stir fans will help distribute the air equally across the house. Test subjects. Chick sorting is a really important part of the process. We select the healthiest chicks for the study. So any birds with chicks with red hawks or patent navels are going to be selected out. And what that's going to do is it's going to help eliminate that first week mortality. So those birds with those patent navels are more likely to succumb to bacterial infections just because they have that opening. And so by taking those birds out, we reduce that first week mortality. And so we help maintain that stocking density that I mentioned on the previous slide. We're going to use single sex experiments because birds are sexually dimorphic. And so by taking a single sex, you reduce the variation in the study pretty directly. We're going to make sure the diet, there's standardization of the diet as well. There's a couple of ways that we do this. We're going to use basal diet manufacturing. For those of you that aren't familiar with this, briefly, what we'll do is we'll put all of the ingredients into the mixer and make the diet. It'll be a finished feed. And we'll put that basal diet up into another bin. And let's say we needed two bins. So we'll make a diet, put it into a bin, make another diet, put it into a second bin. And we'll pull equally from each of those bins and add the treatment. And so what that does is, rather than just having a calculated formulation that is the same, we have physical diets that are the same except for the products that are added. The other way that we make sure we have standardization in the diet in the diets, yeah, is coefficient of variation testing of the mixer. And so we're going to make sure we use an optimal mix time to distribute that product equally in the test feed. Some standardization that we have in the facility itself is broadly, I just call it labeling. Everything has a label to help minimize human error as much as possible. So if you come through our facility, you'll see down there at the bottom, the tube feeder has the pin number on it. I turned the bag around, but the bag has a label as well. And that bucket up in the top left is a mortality bucket. So anything coming out has a label on it, and that helps minimize human error. And we do that across the facility so that it's a standard in our everyday practices. And one of the ways that that helps is, let's say someone pulls a bird out and writes a 2 on its shank, and I come to the table to necropsy that bird, and the 2 looks like a 7 to me, and so I write it as a 7. It helps minimize that human error to some degree. So minimizing that as much as possible is really important in the research as a whole. This might not apply to everyone, but due to the nature of the research that we typically conduct, we're going to have a baseline standard for biosecurity. And so you can see here on the wall, we have boots, we have a dry foot bath there, and hand sanitizer. And so we maintain a baseline level of biosecurity, and that helps make biosecurity part of routine rather than having to rely on memory as far as what the challenge is in a given area. The next way I'm going to talk about helping the experimental design is statistical design. You're really going to want to consult a statistician, whether that's in-house or someone on the consulting side, and get feedback early in the process when you're designing the experiment rather than when the data is collected, because they are likely to have some help, some guideline as far as how to collect samples and maybe even how many replicates to use. And we do this on a regular basis where if we're taking samples we're not accustomed to, we'll go ahead and ask a statistician at the University of Georgia as far as best practices in these circumstances. So I'm not a statistician, but I'm going to give a couple broad points on things to consider in the facility as you design your applied research. So block design is really important, and all of y'all are in academia are pretty familiar with this concept. So this is just a really simple example. We have four treatments in eight blocks. So each of these colors represents a block, and you can see each block has every treatment represented. And so what that's going to do is if there's variation in the facility, it's going to help distribute that variation equally. So in this example, it's a hot day in the summer, and there is air coming in through these cool cells. That air is being cooled. And as it comes across, I'm trying to come across to the left there. As it comes across, it's being warmed. And then right before it exits, it's going to be the warmest. So there's going to be stratification in the air from where the air enters is going to be the coolest. And then right before it exits, it's going to be the warmest. So by blocking them like this, it helps distribute that variation equally amongst the treatments. The next topic that I'm going to discuss is power analysis in the statistical design. It's a really important concept. I'm going to try not to get too in the weeds. I just want to give some generalizations, especially as they apply to the challenge models that we run in applied circumstances, especially ABF. So generally, power analysis, the way I think of it is the probability that under a certain set of circumstances, we're going to have a significant difference. And so typically, as you increase the number of replicates, you're going to increase your statistical power or that probability that you're going to have a significant difference. And generally, as you increase your number of birds, you're going to lower your standard deviation, which will help help declare that difference. The way I think about the bird number is if we had, let's say we had a small bird with a mild peritonitis that lingers throughout the grow cycle. So if we only had 10 birds in that replicate, that one bird is going to skew the average more than if we had 25 or 50 birds in that replicate. They're going to balance, kind of weight that average closer to the true average there. So that's kind of the way I think about bird numbers and influencing variation. So talking a little bit more about replicates specifically, I'm going to use a pretty straightforward example in a non-challenge situation. And I'm just going to go through kind of the assumptions that I made down here at the bottom real quick. I'm going to try to use these same assumptions generally as we go through an example or two. So we're going to assume that the control average weight is 2.5 kilos and that the product being used is going to provide 100 grams increase in that 42-day weight. And so in other words, the average for the control group is 2.5 kilos and the average for the product treated group is 2.6. So we're going to assume those values and we're going to assume that the standard deviation is 75 grams, which is about approximately what that might be at 42 days. And we're going to assume that we're trying to target a p-value of 0.05. So coming back up to this table, if we use three replicates, our power is going to be 0.37. So 37% of the time, we're going to be able to declare that this product providing a 100 gram difference is significantly different. So one out of three studies is another way to think of that. As we increase to six, our power is going to go up to 0.64. So two out of three studies, we're going to be able to declare that difference. As we increase to eight, we're at 0.76. So three out of four. And as you increase to 10 and 12, you exceed kind of that statistical threshold of 0.8 as you increase to 10 and 12 replicates in this specific situation. The issue or maybe not the issue, but in our specific circumstances, we don't have non-challenge groups very often. And so for the purposes of this discussion, I compared a non-challenge group to a fairly severe coccidia challenge. You can see at the top, that image there is severe ballooning from maxima infection. So I'm going to focus on weight gain. So that second column here, I don't know how well my cursor is coming through, but 28-day weight in a non-challenge group, we're looking at a standard deviation of about 47 grams. And I put the coefficient of variation there to the side just for reference, so we can control a little bit for that average. If we look at that same weight in the coccidia challenge group at 28 days, we're looking at a standard deviation of 97 grams. So it's almost double in that group, in the challenge group. But the thing to consider, especially in coccidia studies that are on the floor, you're going to have some recycling of those pathogens. And those birds are typically influenced for the rest of the experiment after being inoculated. These, by the way, were likely inoculated on day 22. So 28 days would be about the peak of replication. So 42-day weight in the non-challenge group, we're looking at 60 grams here, standard deviation, whereas in that coccidia challenge group, we're looking at about 183 grams standard deviation. So it's almost three times the value of the non-challenge group. And so you might be asking, what does that mean? Like I said, we are usually looking at products to influence those challenges. And so I put them kind of in the same scenario we discussed earlier. So we're looking at a 2.5 kilo control weight, and our product is going to add 4% increase, about 100 grams. So in that non-challenge scenario, if our product provides 100 grams of difference, then the standard deviation is 60 grams. We're going to see that significant difference. You can see that power value of 0.96. We're going to have a significant difference almost every time we run that study. Contrarily, if we run that same study in the same parameters, so we have 2.5 kilo control and our 4% increase, we're going to have a power of 0.23. So one out of four of those studies are going to come out significant, because the standard deviation is so much greater in that group than the non-challenge. So I guess in brief, the point that I'm making is you definitely want to consider the challenge and how that's going to influence the standard deviation when you design how many replicates you're going to use. Because I think a lot of times what happens is some of these products have been tested under less or non-challenge conditions. And so there's kind of this this thought that it'll be similar when we move into challenge studies, but challenges typically provide a fair amount of variation. And so it's harder to distinguish those differences with that variation in there. The last point before I leave power analysis is gonna be the delta. So knowing what the margin of gain in a product, or the margin of loss, if you're maybe looking at feed conversion, is going to be really important when you apply this power analysis. And so just some examples here, we use the same assumptions, 2.5 kilos, and we have our improvement there in that first column. So at eight replicates, if there's no improvement, just by statistical chance, there's going to be a 2% power. There's going to be a 2% chance of having a significant difference. If we have a 2% increase, in this case in weight gain, we're looking at a power of 0.27. And as we increase in our delta there to 4%, we're back up to that scenario we talked about previously at 0.76. So three out of four studies are going to come out significant. And as you increase from there, it's almost one. So every time you run those studies, if you create a difference of 6 to 10%, you're going to have a difference every time. So knowing that is that change that's created from the product is really important as you design your experiment. I'm not going to talk too much about benchmarking, but I did want to make a couple comments on benchmarking and specifically on antibiotics. So antibiotics are a good benchmark because they're well characterized and they're widely accepted across industries. However, if you're marketing towards antibiotic-free companies, the products aren't competing directly. And I think there's a mindset that we really want to achieve the same thing as the antibiotics or better even as the antibiotics. But the way that I think of it and Dr. Hoffaker thinks of it is more of a positive control, kind of a what can be achieved and where do we fall in between. And so that's maybe a better way to think of it than trying to perform better than antibiotics, because it's not really the same. The last topic that I wanted to cover was challenge design. So I'm going to make some generalizations. There are a lot of nuances when it comes to challenge design, but I do want to present a couple broader concepts. So when we talk about challenge design in enteric models, we're going to classify them typically as mild, moderate, or severe. We're going to give them ranges. There are times where people want a very specific number, 2.5% mortality. And we typically, we can't achieve or promise that exact value. What we can do and what we typically do is give a range. So we target less than 5% mortality in a lot of situations. As far as guidance in which model to use, in products that are more performance-based, we're looking at a product that's going to be there for the duration of the study and is going to hopefully influence body weight. We're going to guide towards more of a mild challenge versus a product that is looking to intervene in the clinical disease, where we might suggest a more severe challenge where we have more mortality in that situation to evaluate. I say mild to severe. A couple other things to consider is we don't want to go too mild, because what happens is if we go too mild, that it's not going to create enough difference in order to measure the response. And on the other side of that, you don't want to go too severe with the challenge because you can overwhelm the host defenses. So I've seen situations where we had a antibiotic control and the challenge was so severe such that it overwhelmed the host defenses even on antibiotics. So definitely want to try to keep it within a range of challenges. A couple considerations in Amaria infections. So something to consider is where the specific species being evaluated is replicating and where the product is reaching. In a lot of circumstances, the products might be digested or not available past maybe looking here at Meckel's diverticulum, let's say this medium middle part of the intestine. And so in that situation, you're not going to want to target species that are in the distal part of the gastrointestinal tract, like Brunetti or Tinella. You're going to want to focus on Acervulina maybe or even Maxima. The other thing to think about when choosing potentially an Imeria species is how that interacts if you're doing a necrotic enteritis study with Clostridium perfringens. And so there's going to be some gradient in the level of severity of disease based on which Imeria you choose. And in our case, we typically use Maxima for necrotic enteritis challenges, and we modulate the dose in order to change the severity of the model. A lot of products we've seen are thought to intervene in tight junctions, so permeability of the intestine. And so something to consider when you're taking samples is the behavior of the pathogen. So what we're looking at in this depiction is a Coxey challenge. We're looking at a fluorescein labeled dextran after a Coxey challenge from 3 to 9 days post inoculation. And so a dextran should not be able to permeate the gut. And what we're looking at is 5 to 7 days that Coxie challenge. In this case, it was a combined challenge. We have maximum permeability right here at 5 to 7 days post-challenge. So if the product is thought to influence permeability of the intestine, we're going to want to look in that range around 5 to 7 days after infection, because the birds recover astoundingly quick. You can see out here at 9 days, the birds have all but recovered from that that disturbance. So waiting to the end of the experiment is a good idea if the key metric is performance or some other, body weight or feed efficiency. But if your key metric is permeability or intestinal influence, you're going to want to make sure you look at that height of permeability. A little bit more on Imeria. I borrowed this slide from Dr. Mathis. It's really just to demonstrate Coxie shedding over time is an evolution. And so what I think of when I think of Imeria lesion scores and OPGs is they're kind of two different metrics, especially when you take them on the same day, because what we're looking at is the severe lesions occur 24 to 48 hours prior to those maturing and being excreted as unsporulated oocysts. And so if we, for example, if we look at that vaccine at the peak of oocyst shedding, the birds that are excreting the oocysts on that day had those severe lesions 24 to 48 hours prior. So you're kind of looking at two different times, or maybe another way to think of it is really just two different metrics at the same time. But it's something to consider when you're evaluating products and when you're interpreting results. I'm not going to go too in depth on necrotic enteritis because there's a lot of variation that exists. But generally speaking, like we spoke about earlier, if you want to focus on performance, we'll likely guide you to a more mild challenge versus if you're looking at clinical disease, we're going to want to elicit more clinical signs. So if you look at this table below, these are three different models compared side by side. And what we did is we gave Coxie vaccine at day of age to those first two groups and then inoculated them with Clostridium perfringens. You can see weekly starting at 14 weeks in one group and 14 and 15 days on the other. And then we compared that to a group that was reared on litter from a previous necrotic enteritis challenge. And what you can see is the performance, and this happens at other time points too. I just summarized it from 0 to 42 days. Performance is typically more impacted in that reused litter model. So it would be a better model to evaluate performance in versus these more direct challenges, which create a much higher clinical challenge versus that floor pen reused litter model. And the last thing I want to talk about with necrotic enteritis is necrotic enteritis mortality and necrotic enteritis lesions are typically the primary lesion metrics that we take no matter what the study is. We do some intestinal sampling and we can score in different ways, but they would be the primary metrics that we look at. And the way that we view them are separate. Similar to the Imeria, they're two separate situations. So that lesion score, you're looking at a moment in time in that challenge progression, and we're not sure where that moment is exactly, because usually we only take one lesion score at one time. Whereas the necrotic enteritis mortality might start and stop over a 7-day period. And so it's more the progression of the disease and the mortality and a specific moment in time as far as the lesion scores. And something that you're gonna wanna make sure you consider taking birds for a lesion score is you're taking birds out of your sampling pool. And so if lesions are important to you, then it's probably a good idea to take those birds out. But if the primary metric that you want to focus on is performance or necrotic enteritis mortality, those taking those birds are going to reduce that output. So like I was speaking to previously, if you have fewer birds at the end and you have that smaller bird, it's going to weigh that average down. So if you have other metrics, you might not want to take so many birds for lesion scores. But with that, that's just kind of my overview of experimental design. So briefly, to conduct optimal research, we're going to identify a singular outcome of interest, whether that's internal use, marketing, or peer-reviewed research. And then we're going to focus on one aspect at a time, and that'll help guide our project as we move forward. There are circumstances where they can be combined, but for the most part, it's a really good idea to try to focus on one at a time in order to answer that most specific question, that most important question. And then once you have that goal established, we're going to, as we said, we're going to limit variation by standardization. We're going to consider power analysis so we can help maximize our chance to declare that significant difference. And we're going to make sure we optimize the challenge and the sampling from that challenge in order to answer our core question, our core parameter of interest. So with that, I appreciate y'all all listening, and I'd love to entertain any questions.
Well, thank you so much, Dr. Jones. But before we get started answering questions, we'd like to share a brief video, and then we'll be right back to answer the questions that have been submitted during today's presentation. Organic trace minerals come in many types and formulations, leading to confusion about chemistry, terminology, and methodologies. With Balchem's Keysure line of chelated minerals, we provide superior performance and exceptional value by keeping it simple. Binding minerals to the highest quality plant protein-derived amino acids and peptides in our world-class production facilities, using a true chelation process pioneered by Balchem and trusted in both the human and animal arenas for nearly 60 years. The Keysure line delivers proven and consistent bioavailability to maximize performance, and a no-frills pricing approach for greater profitability. Visit BalchemANH.com to see how Keysure chelated minerals are your link to superior performance and exceptional value. As a reminder, you can still submit questions through the questions pane in your attendee control panel, so feel free to do that as we get started here. So, Dr. Jones, your first question is, do you completely clean the facilities in between trials, or do you reuse litter? And what are the pros and cons of each?
It depends on the study. So, a lot of times we will completely clean out between models, except for those situations where someone wants to do a test on our reused necrotic enteritis litter. And what we do when we design that sort of experiment is we'll pull it from one study and then blend it all together and then reapply it to the study with reused litter. Like I mentioned previously, the pros and cons of using reused litter is typically, if you're looking at performance, it does separate performance out maybe more so, because I think what happens is they're subjected to that clinic, that subclinical necrotic enteritis for the entirety of their grow out versus maybe a more direct challenge. But I guess the downside is you don't have as much clinical mortality typically to separate out if you are looking at a product that's going to intervene in the disease process.
Right. One other question is, do you ever use sentinel birds or infected birds that you introduce to a pen to stimulate or simulate a more natural infection?
Yeah, we use a sentinel model more so in our food safety studies, specifically salmonella studies, where we'll use a cedar bird. We'll have direct challenged birds and then some horizontally exposed birds as well. And we'll assess both of those at the end to see whether the, you know, maybe the product in question has an influence directly on the challenged birds, or maybe an effect on how that pathogen is spread in a given replicate. So that would be the primary model where we use sentinels for testing.
Got it. And do you feel that research conducted at universities or very clean facilities produces data that's applicable to the industry?
Yes, I think it is applicable. Like I spoke about previously, when you get to the applied floor pen model, people are going to want to see studies carried out at multiple different institutions, whether that's universities or CROs. And I think there's a lot of clout that comes with universities. And so they're likely going to want to see a university in that lineup, even if they can't simulate it quite an applied level as maybe a CRO can get it. So I think there's a lot of value that comes out of university research as well. And I think it's part of your research portfolio on a product is a really important part.
Wonderful. Okay. Do you see major differences in results from battery pen studies versus floor pens?
Major differences. I guess the way I'll answer that is the battery experiments tend to be more controlled, and so that layer of control helps kind of separate out significant differences easier, I'll say. And so if you take that same number of replications and that difference and move it into the floor pen, you might not see a significant difference like you saw in the battery cage because of the variation that it creates in the floor pen. And a lot of it has to do with recycling of the litter and just a little bit more stress put on those birds. But you can relate them to one another, but a lot of times the battery is more controlled, and so you're more likely to have significant differences than in the floor pen model.
So kind of going back to the beginning, what would you say is the baseline number of replicates needed to start within a given experiment?
Yeah, as far as the, so you're gonna wanna go back to the parameter that you're most interested in, and the influence that you've created. So if you're looking at a floor pen model, you're gonna look back at your battery studies and the influences that you created on that parameter. So let's say I use 4% pretty often. So let's say it was a 4% difference, and you'll use that in your power analysis to help guide you as far as the number of replicates. But I'd say typically that baseline that you're gonna start at is about 8 replicates. For those of you who have done power analysis, I don't know if it's similar with other programs, but the two programs that I typically use both send error messages if I go below 8 replicates. And so a lot of times from a statistical standpoint, it's probably best to start at 8 and move up. But there are circumstances where we might use less than that, depending on whether it's going to be used internally or so on. But yeah, 8 is probably a good baseline to start at and move up.
Wonderful. Sounds good. Can you give us an example of how you would alter pathogen concentration to change the severity of the model?
Yes. So I talked about briefly modulating the dose of maxima is how we a lot of times will modulate the challenge for necrotic enteritis. So I'd say a baseline level that is pretty well reported is about 5,000 sporulated oocysts, and that is a pretty moderate challenge. So if you want a more mild challenge, you might decrease that to 2,500, 3,000 oocysts And then if you want a more severe, you're going to go the opposite direction. The other way that you could change the challenge is the number of days that you give Clostridium perfringens. So typically we give Clostridium perfringens 5, 6, and 7 days after we give Maxima. And that kind of corresponds to that graph I showed you previously, where we have that peak disruption from 5 to 7 days. And so we can change the days we challenge. So instead of challenging on 5, 6, and 7, if we want a more mild challenge, we might only challenge on one of those days rather than all three. And that'll help taper that challenge down a little bit. So yeah,
okay.
You're really just changing the concentration of those two and the exposure to those two.
Your next question is kind of going back to that area where you talked about over-challenging. The question is the data usable from trials in which the birds have been over-challenged, assuming all the groups were treated the same, or does it skew the data too much?
I guess I come from a weird place because I feel like all data is useful data. As far as useful from a marketing standpoint, it will be questioned more if the challenge is too severe versus maybe something that's more relatable, more mild to moderate challenge. But there's a lot of things you can learn from a challenge that, you know, intended or not intended, becomes a little bit severe. So you can learn about, you know, how that product is influencing the clinical side of the equation as well. So there's definitely still a use to it, but as I feel like that question is getting at, it will be questioned more likely if used on the marketing side.
Got it. And your last question, since we're getting close to the top of the hour, what kind of any lesion scoring system do you use?
Yeah, so we use the necrotic enteritis lesion scoring system we use is 0 to 3. Most necrotic enteritis lesion scoring systems are kind of that range from mild to severe. So ours is 0 to 3. There's a lot of systems that are like 0 to 4 and 0 to 5 or 6. And those lesion scoring systems, some of those include mortality as being the most severe lesion. And what that does is it makes the lesion score relate more so to the mortality. It kind of skews the lesion score towards the necrotic enteritis mortality value. And so like I mentioned earlier, we only do that 0 to 3 for that moment in time to kind of give us a progression of the disease at that time. And like I said, it's mild to severe. Mild would be mostly mucus. Moderate would be, so 2 would be that classical, more classical necrosis of the intestine. And then a 3 would be hemorrhaging and or sloughing of the intestine. That's kind of how we score.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much, Dr. Jones, and thank you everyone for attending today's webinar. If you have additional questions, please submit them to anh.marketing@balchem.com, and we'll forward them along with the unanswered questions from today's session. Our next webinar is scheduled for July 20th, where we'll hear from Dr. Kevin Harvatine from Penn State University. As an extension of his past webinar on the impact of seasonal rhythms on milk component yield, he will dive into how daily rhythms can be impacted. We also have Dr. Paul Kononoff from the University of Nebraska joining us on August 3rd to present Feeding the Metabolic Race Car, a review of using starch and fat to support milk production in ruminants. Our next monogastric focused webinar will be on August 10th. When Dr. Jenna Wilson from the University of Georgia will discuss broiler breeder management. Visit balchemanh.com/realscience to learn about our upcoming webinars and to access past event materials. A recording of today's webinar will be available there within 48 hours, so you can revisit this content or pass it along to your colleagues. Balchem's podcast series continues to offer a deeper dive into our webinar topics. We now have 17 episodes out on YouTube, your favorite podcast platform, and also at balchemanh.com/podcast. A new episode discussing the transgenerational impact of poultry diets, featuring Dr. Chris Ashwell and Chandler Keck from North Carolina State University, will be posted tonight, so be sure to subscribe to the Real Science Exchange. On behalf of Balchem and Dr. Jones, thank you for joining us today.